Hi, boys and girls. Welcome to my read-along show. And as always, I have a lot of great things planned as we continue our journey reading The Evolution of Calpurnia Tate, written by Jacqueline Kelly. On today's show, we'll find out what's been happening in Callie's life, at home and at school. And what's this I hear about having to knit with four needles? No wonder Callie was frustrated. We'll have to get some advice on that topic. And for those of you who haven't figured out what an entomologist is, fear not. We have a special guest today, an amateur entomologist naturalist, who will help us understand. I think he's also brought a few surprises. So, let's get started. What did you think about this week's readings? It was especially interesting to me because the author, Jacqueline Kelly, began to pull in many more characters and created little complications for Callie. I felt there wasn't as much emphasis on the scientific information, although it's still important, as it had been in the earlier chapters. Instead, the characters were a bit more developed, and there were many more passages with great believable dialogue. Did you feel you got to know Callie a little bit better? I know I did. I also appreciated all the snippets of humor Jacqueline Kelly wrote in the story. So, what have we learned? Well, we've learned about Callie and her best friend Lula, and how Callie handled her brothers, who had a serious crush on Lula. Then we learned about Callie's growing relationship with her grandfather that almost left her devastated when she realized she hadn't labeled the location of the mutant plant they had found, and how she was resolved to crawl on her hands and knees across 600 acres to search for it. And then the issues at school with her teacher, not to mention Callie's punishment, which landed her in the corner of shame. And of course, the part about Callie caring for 29 toddlers. You thought watching one baby was hard work. What did you think about Petey, the caterpillar? Jacqueline Kelly did a great job describing that part. And oh, how my heart raced when Ajax the dog chased after that giant moth. I kept saying, "Fly away, moth." From all of this, I think we can safely say this character is determined and resilient. So I'll stop here in case some of you have not read to page 200 and simply say the story is really coming together. And it all makes so much more sense as Callie continues to log her many observations of living things in her natural world, and we discover what it was like to be a girl growing up at the turn of the century. Here's my journal of notes. As you can see, I've continued to write important issues right along, things that I'd like to remember, vocabulary words, facts that I've discovered, and here's another technique for some of you that would like to try it. And that's putting post-it notes in the pages that you think are important. I'll have more on Callie and her issues at school, but up next is our special guest, Jeff Hoagland, Education Director at Stony Brook Millstone Watershed Association in Pennington, New Jersey. Welcome, Jeff. What is the difference between an entomologist and a naturalist?
Well, an entomologist is someone who conducts scientific study of insects. And that's often done, there are forensic entomologists, people who look at how insects invade a body, you know, so they can sort of age when something has happened. The vast majority of entomologists are sort of agricultural entomologists, looking at pest insects and how they might impact crops. A naturalist is someone who maybe studies nature, but maybe not quite as disciplined, maybe just celebrates nature. I'm a naturalist. I'm also an amateur entomologist. I'm a naturalist by profession. I teach students outdoors. I also spend a lot of my free time out in the natural world.
So can we say then an entomologist is like a bug specialist who likes bugs and insects?
An entomologist is absolutely a bug specialist. And there's someone who maybe studies them, maybe is conducting experiments. Myself, as an amateur, I raise them as pets.
Wow. Okay. So how did you become interested in being a naturalist and working with bugs?
Well, honestly, I believe every child is interested in that. And it may be fleeting, But I believe we have sort of an evolutionary memory of our connection to the natural world. We grew up there. We needed to understand what plants and animals provided food. We needed to understand what ones were dangerous. And I think we learned through play and through survival about nature. Somewhere along the line, it was just very, very bright to me, very luminous. I think that's maybe just genetics. I have really sensitive hearing. And I also had a father who nurtured that. He saw that and he said, he saw my interest in insects specifically, and he spent time with me exploring insects and engaging me and helping me to really explore that topic and want to learn more.
Well, it seems to me that, you know, your life pretty much seems to parallel this little character in the evolution of Calpurnia Tate, because she's very interested in the outdoors. And in one of the readings, she talks about a yellow grasshopper versus the green grasshoppers. And I was hoping you could explain that a little bit more to us.
Well, first of all, let me tell you, there's a huge variety of grasshoppers.
Okay.
And they start off singing in the month of May, primarily the crickets.
And they're tiny, because I was trying to catch one and I couldn't. It was like half an inch. They're not big and fat yet, are they?
There's different types. actually, the field crickets are about an inch and a half long.
Okay.
Once June rolls around, and they're singing and chirping. There's something called a shieldback katydid.
Cool.
It could be called a shieldback grasshopper. It's brown. It's in the fields. It sounds like, most viewers won't know this, like an electric typewriter.
Okay, cool. Yeah,
and they sing primarily at night.
Okay.
And they're brown. There's a number of green grasshoppers. All the katydids are green grasshoppers. But the story's referring to a mutation, which insects are very prolific. They lay a lot of eggs, and there are mutations, things that just aren't quite the norm with that population. And so in this case, there's one, there's some that are yellow,
mm-hmm.
and it just so happens that they match their environment, and it adds an adaptive, there's an adaptive advantage, which is that they blend in to their environment better than kind of the mother stock, the way the rest of them are.
That's absolutely true, because in her story, she's stating how the yellow grasshopper blended in the drought. All the grasses were kind of faded out, and they lived much longer and became much, much larger. So that's great. We finally have an answer there. And also, can you tell us the difference between a moth and a butterfly?
Well, moths and butterflies, I guess there are a couple of things to key on. Most moths are nocturnal. That is, they're most active at night. They're flying around at night. Most butterflies are diurnal. Most of those things that you see fluttering around during the day, those are butterflies. Now, I want to stress the word most, because there are some moths and butterflies that, well, I don't know about butterflies. There are some moths who sneak in and they're active during the day. But if you had one in hand, you'd see a couple of other differences. The bodies of moths tend to be more robust. Moths, when they rest, hold their wings sort of folded over their back like a triangle.
Oh, cool. Okay.
Butterflies either hold their wings straight up over their back or straight out at the sides. Butterflies tend to have filamentous antenna. Moths have more ornate antenna.
What are your suggestions? What do you think is a good time to catch them and then release them, and fireflies and all the goodies that summer brings?
Well, my advice to any parent, any kid, is just get outside. So that's the first step.
Absolutely.
I'm a parent, and I have no TV, and I find screen time is very invasive. I have kids who now have iPods or iPhones or whatever they're called, and it steals away their time. So first step is get outside. Insects are everywhere. So go to one of your favorite places, and if you have a specific interest in insects, you can key in on things. For instance, summertime is here. Go out, look for flowers. Flowers have fuel. They have pollen that some insects collect and eat, and they have nectar, which many insects feed on. So going and visiting different types of flowers, you'll discover that some of them attract more insects than others. Milkweed's a great plant because it has great nectar. It also acts as a host for the caterpillars of monarch butterflies. So you can have the fun of searching for eggs and or caterpillars that are feeding on the leaves.
One of the things that I used to do was just take a white sheet and lay it next to a field and wait and see what popped on. Or after the grass is cut, put a sheet down and see what jumps onto the white sheet.
I love the white sheet trick, is what I call it. And I have a variation, which is to go spread this out underneath your favorite shrub, And, you know, I was a little boy, so it had to involve a stick. It doesn't need to involve a stick. You can just rustle the leaves of the plant that it's under.
Great.
And
okay.
Those who are living there, feeding there, resting there, tend to drop off and land on the sheet. And you get a real quick look at who's living there. And this is not a native creature, though some people may recognize it as a cockroach. This is a Madagascar hissing cockroach.
Wow.
And I brought a male and a female. This is the male. The male has these bumps here on its thorax. And in nature, it would hiss when it's distressed because it will try to warn off the predator and pretend that it offers a threat to the predator itself.
Can you guess about its age? Would it be the number of these little
No,
ridges?
Those
no,
segments
like
are determined. And
okay.
The funny thing with insects, we often think small means young, but in reality, if an insect has wings, most insects are winged, and when they have wings, that means they're an adult, they're full grown. So baby butterfly is a caterpillar. Caterpillar turns into a butterfly.
So does this guy have like little eyelids?
Well, not eyelids. It has compound eyes
okay.
under here.
Okay.
And it's got antenna. This is a creature built for survival. So I don't know what Darwin had to say about cockroaches, but there's a lot of jokes about how these would survive any nuclear event.
Right?
It can't hurt you. Some kids are very nervous about them because
their
claws. Let me just see if this other one wants to demonstrate why they're called hissing cockroaches.
Okay.
It might not.
Wow.
No, I don't think it's going to.
You know, it's sort of pretty in a weird sort of way. Oh, my goodness.
I think there is great beauty in them.
Yeah.
I think anybody who's had experiences with cockroaches, the school lunchroom. Sure.
Okay, he's actually very soft.
I always joke with kids
yeah,
that we actually
that
got
bad.
These from their school, but we didn't.
Right.
You can actually see their little holes here along their abdomen. This
oh,
is
yeah,
actually
yeah,
how
yeah,
they
yeah.
breathe. Those are the spiracles.
Wow.
They don't have a respiratory system like ours. Air just goes into the body. The oxygen just diffuses into them, and that's
And what
how
do
they
feed off of?
These would feed on detritus, fruit bits and things. We feed them fruit. We feed them dog food. So I don't want to call them pets. They are very easy to care for.
Thank you so much for being here. I'm sure our viewers have come away with lots of new ideas and have a greater understanding of what an entomologist does. Have you ever wondered what schools and kids look like around 1899? Well, I found a book titled Schoolhouses of Early Burnett's Township. This book may just supply us with some answers. Let's take a look. Schools were very different around Callie's time. Many schools consisted of one room. Some buildings used as schoolhouses were converted churches. Logs, wood, brick, or stone were used to construct these early schools. Inside the school, a large pot-belly iron stove warmed the room. It also warmed the children's lunch pails and kept the inkwells from freezing during the winter months. The teacher's desk was located in front of the classroom on a raised platform, 6 to 8 inches high. Across the top of the desk was a shelf that acted as a storage compartment for wooden rulers, primers, a handbell, and registers. And in front of the teacher's desk was a long bench where the children recited their lessons. The children's desks were wooden with an open box top for storage. Each desk was equipped with a pencil holder and an inkwell. Some desks sat one child while others sat two. Ornate ironworks along the sides helped to support the desk frame. Children often walked several miles to school, even in harsh winter months. And one problem was, if they paused for too long, their leather boots froze. In some communities, a school wagon called a state was horse-drawn and transported students to consolidated schools. The teacher taught as many as 30 students, ranging from grades 1 through 8. They studied and memorized lessons from a single book and mostly learned the 3 R's, reading, writing, and arithmetic. Children wore leggings, button-down shoes, and some even wore fashionable hats. Most often, when photographed, children and adults took on a very dignified and serious look. However, some school photos reveal a few children sporting grins. Eventually, one school rooms gave way to larger schools with separate classrooms like those of today. And that wraps this session. I'll be moving on to the next 100 pages or so, probably ending with chapter 25. Armed with so many new ideas, I hope you will continue to read The Evolution of Calpurnia Tate by Jacqueline Kelly. record observations in your journal, and keep track of words, ideas, and things in your notebook. Here's a glimpse of what's in store for next week. We'll not only find out about Callie's adventures, but also take a look at her family's Thanksgiving menu, and just how does one knit with four needles? Last but not least, we'll savor some of Callie's recipes and learn how to make our own pie dough. Let's see now, chapter 16. The telephone comes. Although some species may be increasing, more or less rapidly, in numbers, all cannot do so, for the world would not hold them all. See you guys.